everybody, it's Lorelei. Welcome to the start of episode 2 of Umineko. Episode 1 was such a wild ride that I don't even know how episode 2 will continue from it. But anyway, I really enjoyed reading your comments as we played through episode 1. It really made it feel like we were on a journey together. To something better, I don't know. But anyway, without further ado, let's just get right into today's episode. Episode 2, Turn of the Golden Witch. Good morning. The Golden Witch has been waiting impatiently for you. Please take your seat opposite her at the table. Have you rested well and deliberated over how you will play? The witch has high expectations of you and is determined to come at you right from the opening. I, too, am looking forward to observing your moves. The difficulty level is first rate. The witch plans to make you surrender in an instant. What? This really makes it sound like it's a game that we are playing with the witch. Kind of getting scared. Can I start? Oh.
Hora, George-sama, mite kudasai.
Shannon found a pair of hammerhead sharks playfully swimming in the tank and made a fuss like a great schooler seeing an aquarium for the first time.
うん、本当に可愛いね。食べちゃいたいくらいだよ。
Eat them? No way!
そんなのかわいそうです。知ってますか?
水族館に来て美味しそうなんて言い出すのは世界中でも日本人だけなんだそうですよ。そうなんだ。アメリカ人でもイタリア人でもきっと食べちゃいたいって言うと思うよ。えっと、その…似合ってるよ、その服。本当に。What's
happening? First, we are transported into an aquarium. And now the two of them are on a date. What's happening? Shannon embraced her chest with both hands in embarrassment. The clothes do look good on her, though. She apparently felt like she was being made fun of for wearing these clothes that she wasn't used to. Even though George's face didn't show it, the truth was that even he was surprised at how easily those tremendous words had left his lips. What? And he was as embarrassed as Shannon on the inside. However, when he saw how embarrassed Shannon was, he started to feel as though he was teasing the girl he liked, and instead of embarrassment, ticklish amusement welled up in him. Wait, that isn't just a feeling. I really am teasing the girl I like. It pains me to admit it. But I used to think that such embarrassing expressions had fallen so far out of use that they no longer showed up even in manga. On the contrary, if I'd seen a couple acting like that, I'd have felt like throwing rocks at them. However, even if rocks were thrown at us now, I'm sure they would be just like confetti celebrating us. Now I can't even remember those lonely days. When I felt jealous of couples who were completely oblivious to their surroundings. To use an old-fashioned phrase, these would be truly rose-colored days. I was so entranced that I no longer even noticed a big tank of the world's largest aquarium. Instead, I saw only Shannon happily playing with the fish, all her changing emotions showing on her face. So, I just realized, but now we're in George's perspective. In episode 1, it was Butler mostly, but now it's George. This will be interesting.
この大水槽がここの最大の売りだそうだからね。なんでも 世界で最大なんだそうだよ。
そうなんですか? それはすごいですね。 本当に素敵です。 水槽じゃなくて、まるで 海の一部をナイフですっと切り取ってここに運んできたみたい。
そうだね。これはもう立派な小さな海だね。
Despite its size, I hadn't thought of the tank as anything more than a tank. That's why I thought her expression about slicing off a part of the sea with a knife was so interesting. No matter how far humans broaden their experiences, in the end, they can only hold a single personal worldview. Maybe that's why it's so interesting to interact with someone who has a different worldview. I said that to her honestly, and she responded,
確かにこれは本当の海ではないかもしれません。でもここに泳ぐ彼らが海だと信じたなら、これは確かに海なんです。
たとえ有限の水槽の中だったとしてもね。
海だって有限ですよ。ううん、仮に無限だったとしても、私たちは生きているうちにどれほどの広さを行き来できるんでしょうね。きっとそれは海よりずっと狭い。
確かに皮肉な話だね。世界はこんなにも広いのに、僕たち人間のほとんどは自分の国からも出ずに生涯を終える。
そこが完成された世界だと信じられるなら、たとえ狭い井戸の底だったって立派な世界で、海なんです。そこに住むカエルにとっては。
Shannon, who spent her days as a servant on a small island 10 kilometers in circumference called Rokenjima, said that with a smile. Turn off the golden witch.Oh, it's like a opening scene again, like in episode 1. I quite enjoy this opening scene because it's like, it really feels like we're watching a movie or something. After we finished walking through the whole aquarium, we had a slightly late afternoon lunch at a restaurant with a nice view. Any boy's heart would jump about at the sight of a buffet. I myself was like that in the past. But with Shannon beside me, this buffet felt different. I couldn't shamefully make a huge pile of nothing but my favorite foods. I was, how should I put it, worried about my appearance.And chose a menu suited for a snob. Toast, salad, and coffee. If I were by myself, I'd have made a pile of greasy stuff like yakisoba, mashed potatoes, gratins, and the like.
Shannon はそんな程度でお腹が足りるのかい?だとしたら、男ってのは本当に燃費の悪い生き物らしいね。
別にそういうつもりじゃなくて。
On Shannon's tray, there was only tea and salad. Maybe the very idea that she could get away with at least one more dish indicated I was thinking with my male stomach.
George 様こそ、それで足りるんですか?男の方はもう少し召し上がった方が良いかと思います。 普段のジョージ様だったらもう少しお昼を召し上がられていると思いますよ。
しまった、そうか。シャノンには僕が本家で昼食をとるときどれくらい食べてるのかバレてるんだったね。
This is so funny. He didn't even think of that.
はい、だから今日はお腹の具合でも悪いのかと思いまして。
Shannon was showing concern that I wasn't feeling well. Apparently, I hadn't made her worry with my stupid attempt to impress her. And in any case, it didn't seem like my stomach was going to let me keep this pretense up any longer.
いやもう白状するよ。ついついカッコつけちゃってね。女の子と一緒だからって遠慮しちゃって。
It's cool of him to confess that he was trying to look cool.
だと思いました。親族会議でのお昼の食べっぷりから考えて、それではとても足りないと思いましたので、遠慮なさらずに、どうぞもう一皿を取りに行ってきてくださいな。
ずるいな、僕ばっかり恥ずかしいよ。じゃあシャノンはどうなんだい？普段からこんな小食で後ろ宮家のお勤めがこなせるのかい？
Shannon grew silent and blushed bright red. Apparently, I wasn't the only one putting on a front. When I realized that, my embarrassment disappeared completely.
なんだ、シャノンもそれじゃ足りないんじゃないか。そうだよ、そうだよ。普段のランチなら、もう少し量が多いものをペロリと平らげてたよ。
女の子のお腹は魔法でできてるから、これが…
ということは、僕たちは互いに見えっ張りだったってことになるね。もう、遠慮はなしにしないかい？
I smiled to show that I wouldn't make fun of her anymore and stood up from the seat.
せっかく沖縄まで来たのに、ゴーヤを食べないのはもったいないからね。ゴーヤの炒め物でも持ってくるよ。
I'm still wondering, when is this taking place? Before the murders? Or...I mean, obviously it would be before, but I'm confused. But let's just see what happens.
Shannon も一緒に行こうよ。ほらほら。
はい。
To anyone watching us, we might have seemed like a pretty humorous and above all embarrassing couple. But it's only after becoming a couple that you realize.This banter means the world to us and is our world. So, no matter how cold the looks we might have been getting from other people, we wouldn't even notice. Indeed, at this age, I finally understand the feelings of couples who want to endlessly flirt without any regard to the surroundings. After I returned with a plate piled up with fried food, Shannon arrived with a lovely cake.While laughing at our fake stoicism, we resumed our lunch.
せっかく海を一望できる展望レストランなのに、あいにくの曇天が悔やまれるね。
Our window seats, which we were lucky to get, showed us seaside scenery so grandiose that it didn't even fit entirely within our field of vision. Man, I would love to see a view like that in real life. However,Because of the cloudy sky, it was a far cry from its normal beauty.
そうですね。晴れていたら、さぞや真っ青な海を見せてくれたでしょうに。
そうだね。普段、六軒島で海を見慣れてると思うけど、ここの海はきっと格別な青さを見せてくれたはずだよ。残念だな。
あ、でも、お仕事の最中に見る海は、どんなに青くても灰色と同じです。でも、今日はお仕事中じゃないから、その…
Apparently, Shannon was doing her best to say an embarrassing line, but I grated harshly.
惜しいな。ジョージ様と二人きりで見る海なら、たとえ灰色でも、真っ青に見えますって言えたら100点満点でご褒美だったんだけどな。 ご褒美は何だったか聞きたい？
その、聞いてもいいものでしたら。
ダメ、教えない。
ずるいですよ、そんなの。
When I was in elementary school, I was always the kid that got bullied. When everyone teased me, I grew nervous and speechless to the delight of the bullies. Back then, I wondered why everyone teased me. But now, teasing Shannon like this, I understand why. This is so much fun. I can play with her emotions however I please. I don't think that's a very fun thing to do. And I can have them all to myself. Right now, I can't think of any higher pleasure. Which is exactly why I have to treat her lightly. I don't want her to get embarrassed and have a bad time. So I decided to end the topic there and then. It's not good to be too persistent.
お昼が終わったら海岸を歩いてみないかい？ひょっとすると雲が晴れて素敵な海が見られるかもしれないよ。
そうですね。行ってみたいです。
うん、そうしよう。でも、そのケーキも本当に美味しそうだね。僕も同じものを持ってこようかな。
いけません。お昼にそんなに食べた上にケーキまで食べたら太っちゃいますよ。ジョージ様は秀吉様の血が濃いみたいですから、気をつけないとおデブさんになっちゃいます。
I don't think that's how it works, but okay, Shannon.
じゃあシャノンは僕がおデブになったら嫌いになっちゃう？僕はたとえシャノンがおデブになっちゃっても嫌いにならないよ。
そういう意味じゃなくて、ちゃんと体を気遣わないと健康にって、
母さんにもよく注意されるよ。やっぱり僕も太極拳とかを始めて運動しないとダメかな。
ダイエットは無茶な運動よりも食生活の見直しから始めた方がいいんですよ。その上で運動を重ねないと効果が出ないんだそうです。
つまりそれはデザートのケーキは控えろってことだね。じゃあ仕方ないからシャノンがそのケーキを頬張るところを眺めていてあげるよ。
そう、ケーキ丸々一つはさすがに食べ過ぎだと思いますけど、半分くらいだったら大丈夫かもしれません。これ本当に美味しいんですよ。
Shannon cut her own cake and tried to move half to my salad plate. I had no doubt that she wanted to share the flavor of the delicious cake with me. Even so, I deliberately and meanly pulled my plate away from her. She blinked her eyes in surprise. She couldn't seem to figure out if that was a refusal of the cake or not. So I winked, opened my mouth and said, Ah!
それが一番したかったんですね。もう、ジョージ様は甘えん坊です。はい、
While still wearing an embarrassed, exasperated face, Shannon offered the cake to me with a fork. Chomp! It tasted like cheap chocolate cake you could find anywhere. Still, it was exceptional. Because eating cake in such an embarrassing way, as if we were the ultimate stereotypical lovey-dovey couple, had been my dream for many years. It made this cake's flavor heavenly.If the earth is destined to end someday, I wouldn't have had any regrets if it happened right then. It was such a moment of bliss. Oh no. Okay. After that, we gathered shells, ran from the waves, and enjoyed each other's company while walking along the beach.After that, we gathered shells, ran from the waves, and enjoyed each other's company while walking along the beach. In the end, the clouds never parted. However, we both believed that our eyes were still reflecting a deep blue sea.
なんだか幸せすぎて怖くなります。
たまに言うね。 何を怖がることがあるんだい？
私、後ろ宮家にお仕えする使用人です。そんな私が、後ろ宮家に連なる方と、こう、その、過ぎたことのように思えて。
僕もびっくりしてるよ。シャノンちゃんと出会ったのは、昨日今日のことじゃない。何年も前から面識もある。でも、年に何度もない親族の会合の席で挨拶をするだけ。そんな君とこうして一緒に過ごせる関係になるなんて、全然想像できなかったよ。それは、シャノンもでしょ？
私は、その…
ん？
想像だけは、してました。
ああ？
いえ、その、あの…想像というよりは、その…妄想みたいなもので、いつも紳士的で思いやりのあるジョージ様とご縁があったらなって、その妄想をしてただけで。
じゃあ、僕たちの縁は君のその信じた心のおかげだね。思う力には魔法が宿るんだよ。だから、その魔法がきっと僕らを巡り合わせてくれた。
そうですね。多分きっと、それは本当に魔法だったんだと思います。
でもね、そんなことはないんだよ。僕の中でも、毎年出会うたびに美しく見違えていった君の存在は、とても大きくなっていた。そして、君にとっての僕も、同じものだとしたなら、今日ここに僕らがあることは必然の結果であって魔法や奇跡なんかじゃないのさ。
ううん、奇跡はあったんです、ジョージ様。
She stopped at the water's edge and gazed beyond the sea.
奇跡？
ううん、魔法あったんです。
I was bewildered by that slightly mysterious expression, which I sometimes heard her use.
魔法か？
はい、魔法です。言っても信じてくれないでしょうから、言いません。でも、確かにその魔法には、私とジョージ様を巡り合わせてくれる、奇跡を叶える力がありました。
それは、何かのおまじないのこと？
そうですね。そういうものの類かもしれません。一つ違うのは、おまじないなんかじゃなく、本当に本当の魔法だったという点です。
I really wonder what she's talking about. Perhaps Shannon isn't alone in wanting to credit an encounter on a miracle or on chance. It might be a universal thing all girls share. For men like me, an encounter with a girl is 70% effort to try to please her and 20% raw courage. And only 10% chance. What she believes to be everything carries little relative weight within me. Maybe that's why my way of thinking is in itself calculating and typical of men. But were I to express that in words, any kind of magic would be broken. I do think that to become this close have taken many fortuities, concessions, and great efforts from both of us. We have this private time together now only as the result of all those things put together.And if she wants to call that magic, that isn't strange in the slightest. That's why I answered her the way I did.
そうだね。同じ運命を100回繰り返したら、僕と君がこういう関係になる結果は、一度しか起こらないものだったかもしれないね。互いを意識し合いながらも、僕たちは他人行儀な関係を今も続けていたかもしれない。そんなよその世界の僕らから見れば、今の僕たちは、まさに奇跡のような関係に違いないだろうから。
そういうのじゃなくて、本当に魔法なんです。 男の方にいくら言ってもこういうのは信じてもらえないんでしょうか。カノン君も全然信じてくれませんし。
信じるよ。僕が信じなくて魔法が解けたら嫌だからね。
Isn't that what Maria was saying? Battler doesn't believe in Beatrice and that's why the magic broke.
ジョージ様。
In a small voice, I apologized for making light of her magic. Those words seemed to make Shannon a lot happier. After all, if a pair of people believes in the magic of love, it becomes eternal.
そうそう。僕からわがままが一つあるんだけど、聞いてもらえないかな。
はい？何でしょうか？
そのジョージ様って呼び方。嫌いじゃないけど、もうなしにしないかい？もちろん、後ろ宮家では対面もあるだろうから、六軒島での普段まで強制はしないよ。でも、二人きりの時は、なしにしよう。うん、そういうルールにしよう。
ルールですか。もし破ったらどうなるんでしょう。
そうだね。ルール違反には、何か罰ゲームがないといけないかもしれないね。そうだな、聞きたい？
いえ、聞きたくありません。
何がいいか僕も考えておくことにするよ。
はい、ジョージさん。
うん、素敵な響きだね。嬉しいよ、シャノン。
私もサヨという名前があります。
そっか、ルールはフェアじゃないといけないね。僕もそれを守って今から君のことをサヨと呼ぶことにするよ。いいね、サヨ。
はい。
I put my arm around her shoulder and held her close. Her delicate body was pulled irresistibly towards me and she leapt into my chest like a doll. As I held her head in my arms, we looked at the horizon together.
真っ青な海だね。この海を二人で見られてとても嬉しいよ。
私もです。この真っ青な海をあなたと二人で見ることができて。
As you gazed at the gray sea and a light rain began to sprinkle down, we kept listening to each other's heartbeats. Oh no. The sound of waves soaked into my ears. No, this was the sound of raging waves. My body, bathed in painfully cold splashes, did not allow me to forget. The memory of the day when my old fate was broken and smashed. What? In the past, tomorrow had been literally like a mirror to me. All I could see in it was the same me that existed today. My tomorrow would never be any different from my today. That was my old fate. But at the moment, for the first time, I saw a different fate beyond the mirror. The witch whispered. She tempted me to take a bite out of the fruit of knowledge. She tormented me, saying that as long as I stayed in the paradise of God, I would remain furniture. And so I learned of love and decided to choose to become a person. Those days were like sweetly melting honey. But then I hadn't realized that they were the beginning of days filled with a new kind of suffering. Is this about Shannon? Taking a motorboat that I had just been told about, I made my way to this islet. No, I couldn't possibly call it an islet. It'd really be more appropriate to call it a reef. It had a torii and a small shrine for the local deity. It was probably built to worship the guardian deity of Rokkenjima. Even though I didn't know the exact meaning, I understood that it had a holy significance. Despite being in a place like this, I took just one more look around to see if there was anyone observing me. The only things I could see were the stormy ocean, Nijima looming in the distance, and the waves breaking against Nokenjima's steep cliffside. I readied myself, timidly approaching a small shrine, and took up the mirror that had been placed there. It was an old-looking mirror, dim and dirty. If it were an ordinary mirror, that would probably give you a terribly bad impression of its value. However, since the mirror had been offered to this small shrine, that quality made me feel some kind of divinity from it. And I realized, this was not merely a mirror. Even if it was nothing more than an old-looking mirror to a non-believer like myself, in actuality, it was a mirror that had an important meaning. Is it really all right to break it after being captivated by honeyed words? No, this is no mirror. It is the inescapable life I had lived until today, my fate. Break it. Break it and cease alive from beyond the mirror. If I don't break it, my life will forever be a pair of facing mirrors. Nothing will ever change in the slightest. The witch whispers. She tempts me to take a bite out of the fruit of knowledge. Or maybe I have already had a taste of that fruit. Because I ended up knowing those maddening emotions. Just as Adam and Eve felt compelled to pluck the fig leaf, I can no longer go without breaking this mirror. I fought with conflict for many days. Inside my heart, the virtuous part of me and the part that sided with the witch repeatedly fought each other. And now, here I am. Did the part of me who is here win or lose? There's only one thing I know. To obtain something, you must be ready to lose something. The cowards who don't risk loss and never try to change anything will never be given the key to open a path to a new future. The key is already in my hands. It is to break this. To break it. Is there any other effort I can make as furniture imprisoned on Nokenjima? No. There's nothing but this. Come, have courage. I'll free myself from being mere furniture. And I'll accept my new sufferings and become human. These are surely the small and large trials I must impose on myself. Now, break it. Break the eternally unchangeable fate that imprisons me into pieces. I raised it high, thought back on all those days of conflict, and, after a time far too brief to do them justice, I finished my reflections and threw it. The mirror? Sounds like it. Ooh. The thunder roared, crying out against me for my outrageous act. It was truly the wrath of the angels, preparing to banish me from eternal paradise. I looked down on the mirror tumbling at my feet, broken in two equal parts. And, having made sure I had accomplished my task, I looked up at the enraged sky and screamed.
Yakusoku wa守りました!
Oh my goodness. The thunder roared once more. I had already been banished from paradise. So, I would have to struggle by myself in order to live. The witch had said it. That's a single element of the world. To lose it means to lose the world. Like how a flask with a hole in the bottom can't be filled. No matter how much water you scoop into it.
Beatrice!
Oh my goodness, I'm getting chills. It's the opening again. We'll watch it one more time. Yeah, okay. I definitely learned a bit more from this. I think it's the same opening that played, but now that I know the characters, it has a lot more meaning. And we see a lot of new characters that we haven't seen yet. And there is that scene where Maria was in the garden with Beatrice. So I guess she really did meet Beatrice. I don't know. My mind wandered back to the days when I could barely imagine the happiness I have today. I was a middle schooler at the time. An ordinary girl who dreamed about love, as is normal at that age. But I really should not have dreamed that dream. Because I am furniture. Furniture is nothing more than a tool, and it's not human. For a person less than human such as myself, just receiving my education was more than sufficient happiness. So even thinking about love was more than I deserved. The Ushinomiya Family Conference was a customary event held every October. But relatives would occasionally visit at other times as well. Of course, they didn't come just to drink tea. On this day, Eva's family had visited the head family on Nokenjima. The three people from Krause's family and the three people from Eva's family had gathered in the parlor. And were having a friendly chat as they updated everyone on their situations. Genji had supposedly told Kinzo of Eva's family's arrival, but he hadn't come down yet. He was probably immersed in his own research and couldn't spare the time. This often happened, so the others waited patiently for their fickle father to come down.
Oh,それは頼もしいじゃないか.
You know, as much as Krause is being annoying ass in the last episode, kind of missed seeing their faces.
お父さんのところでたくさん勉強して
早く手助けができるよう頑張りたまえ。ありがとうございます。今は父の紹介でたくさんの人生の先輩方に本当に貴重な勉強をさせていただいています。そのいずれも学校では学べないことばかりです。学校で習うのは国語算数やない。物を学ぶ姿勢と態度を学ぶんや。その基礎ができて
You know, this is actually something very, very true, especially in Asian cultures where studying or academics are basically the end-all be-all, and people don't really think about what's beyond that in the real world, so to speak.
うん。全くその通りだよ。秀吉さんの教育方針はいつも本当にご立派ですな。ジョージもまだまだ半人前や。それを常に忘れんで勉強に励むんやで。よしなさいよ、あなた。ジョージはいつも一生懸命頑張ってるわよ。
ねえ。本当に立派ね。うちのジェシカにも爪の垢を分けてもらいたいわ。チェ。まだテストの結果を根に持ってるのかよ。受験勉強は私なりにやってるって。こんな席でまで言うことはねえだろうよ。うせえぜ。When
George was praised for his diligence, the conversation would nearly always turn to Jessica, who hated studying. Jessica made an openly displeased face, as though she'd known it would come back to her.
やれやれ。ジェシカは勉強と一緒に、少しはおしとやかな言葉遣いも学ぶ必要があるんじゃないかね。後ろ宮家の家紋を背負う一人娘が、それではみっともないな。
あら。 これはこれで魅力的よね。時代は変わるのよ。男に食わしてもらうために定宿を装わなくてはならなかった時代はとっくに終わってるんだから。
そうそう、やっぱエヴァおばさんは分かってますね。
はあ、今日は頭痛が特にこたえます。
大丈夫ですか？夏日おばさん、顔色が優れないみたいです。
ありがとう。大丈夫です。でも本当に月日が経つのは早いものね。半ズボン姿で浜辺を駆け巡ってずぶ濡れになって帰ってきた日がついこの間のように思います。
それはジェシカちゃんも同じよね。今じゃお化粧の仕方にだってこだわるレディーなんだから。眉にこだわりがあるのね。今日のあなたとってもキュートよ。
ありがとうございます。誰も気づいてくれなかったんで自信なくしてたとこです。
A smile rose to Jessica's face as the results of her own studies were finally noticed. Eva smiled back just as widely. Then she turned that smile towards Natsuhi.
ダメよ、夏日姉さん。自分のこの小さな変化にも気づかなくちゃ。かわいそうなジェシカちゃん。一番最初にお母さんに気づいてもらいたかったでしょうに。ね
え。いいんです、いいんです。あの人、そういうの全然気づかない人なんで。
ジェシカ、母親をあの人呼ばわりとは感心できんね。
It's definitely quite rude to address your parent as that person instead of calling them mother. So, yes, I think it's a fair point to berate her for this or scold her for it.
謝りなさい。
言葉遣いについては後でよく言って聞かせます。
チェ、お子様は邪魔だってんならそう言ってくれよ。私は席を外させてもらうぜ。ここは空気がよどんでるぜ。
ジェシカ。
Jessica was still at that unpredictable age with exams right around the corner. Recently, she had clashed often with her mother, who was enthusiastic about her education.
失礼いたします。
Jessica making to leave the parlor in a bad mood, and Shannon pushing a serving cart loaded with tea, bumped into each other.
ああ、シャノン。私の分のお茶はいらないぜ。私は庭でもほっつき歩いてくる。
お嬢様？
シャノン、お茶が冷めます。配膳を急ぎなさい。
失礼しました。
Shannon hadn't actually done anything wrong. But Natsuhi, who felt like some shame to herself had been shown, lashed out at her emotionally.At least, not to the extent Rosa did. This was something that often happened in the Ushinomiya family. But it seemed that Shannon wasn't strong-willed enough to accept it that way. But honestly, no one has to put up with this, you know? In the ideal world, they should not take their emotions out on other people, but...We don't live in an ideal world, and I guess we do often have to make the best of it. Still, doesn't mean it's right. She shrunk back and nervously prepared the black tea. She had the unfortunate habit of making more mistakes when she felt intimidated. Her pitiful appearance dispersed the peaceful atmosphere that had been there until just a moment ago.That wasn't really Shannon's fault, but she thought she might be the source and felt a pressure on her chest. Her shaking fingers made the porcelain clatter, and you couldn't have called it graceful, not even as an empty compliment. The more pitiful everyone thought that was, the greater the silence grew. The more irritated Natsuhi looked, and the more Shannon cowered.Shannon's thin neck felt like it was being choked and suffocated by the death god called tension. Then, George spoke cheerfully as if to blow away the stiff atmosphere.
これはいい香りだね。何の紅茶かな？
これは。
ううん、言わないで。当てるから。これは特徴的な匂いだから、多分わかるよ。アールグレイかな。
He really has some sense, when it comes to speaking.
多分、そうだと思います。
多分、アールグレイで合ってるよ。台所に戻ったら、紅茶の缶を見てごらん。
ほう、ジョージ君は紅茶に詳しいのかね？
お世話になっている社長さんに、紅茶の詳しい人がいまして、講釈を聞いているうちに、少しだけわかるようになりました。
ああ、おこのぎ食品の社長さんかい。あの人、そういううんちくは得意やな。
紅茶の名前って産地を示すことが多いんでしょ？じゃあこれはアールグレイという土地で栽培されたのが由来なのかしらね。
昔イギリスにグレイ伯爵という人がいたそうで、その人にちなんでつけた名前だそうだよ。ちなみにこの特徴的な匂いは茶葉のものではなくて、ベルガモットというみかんの親戚にあたる果物でつけたものなんだって。
そうなの。初めて知りました。そういう知識を持っていると紅茶もより美味しくいただけますね。
酒もタバコも同じや。嗜好品はロマンをたしなむもんやで。こういううんちくが味わいを深めるんや。
薬の脳ガキと同じよね。夏日姉さんも愛用してる頭痛薬の説明書、今度はじっくり読んでから飲んでみなさいよ。
This is the one part I don't miss.
それはいい。今夜試してみなさい。
It's such an asshole move.
ええ、試してみます。
シャノンちゃん、そのポットを開けてごらん。茶葉の中にベルガモットを乾燥させたものが混じっているのを見つけられるはずだよ。
います。オレンジの皮を乾燥させたようなものが混じっています。
うん、多分これがベルガモットだね。アールグレイの香りの主成分だよ。匂いは鮮烈だから味がきつそうな印象があるけど、素直で飲みやすい味なんだよ。ミルクティーにすると香りもまろやかになって素敵かもしれないね。みんなに注いでポットに余った分があったら、ぜひミルクティーにして飲んでみるといいよ。
はい。ありがとうございます。
George gave her a small wink. Shannon finally realized that George had been doing her a favor by calming down the atmosphere in the room. And he had been doing it for her sake, as she had lost her self-confidence. The Ushinomiya family did not pamper their servants. So, if there was any awkwardness, they would be harshly punished.So it didn't often happen that they were given a helping hand like this. Thanks to George's concern, Shannon was somehow able to get a hold of herself and finish serving everything safely. If she was calm when she worked, she could easily carry out her tasks elegantly and flawlessly. By the time the black tea was laid out on the table and the elegant scent drifted around,The room was completely back to how it had been, in a peaceful mood, as everyone praised George's knowledge. Shannon wanted to thank him for saving her, but it didn't look like she would get a chance. So she at least thanked him inside her heart, praying to God that George would hear it, and pushed a serving cart away. I wonder if that means she's religious.
George-san wa...昔からそういう時には助け舟を出してくれるんだよ。話題をさらりと変えてくれるというかさ。
Shannon and Jessica could be seen in a rose garden. Jessica, having gotten into a fight with her mother, now felt unable to simply nonchalantly wander back into the parlor, and so found herself here killing time.
思い返せば、こういう助けられ方をしたのは、今回が初めてじゃない気がします。
Whenever I made a careless mistake and George-sama was there, he would always naturally smooth things over and make things harmonious, I think. Maybe it wasn't something as direct as picking up a fork that had been dropped, but that was his way of caring. Even servants have pride. They want to fix their own mistakes by themselves. Because if a guest helped them out with that, they would lose face.
そういう空気を読むのが得意なんだろうぜ。まあ、ジョージ兄さんの美学なんだろうよ。あの人、妙に気ざったらしいところあるからな。
そんなことありません。とっても素敵な方だと思います。
ひょっとしてシャノン、ジョージ兄さんに惚れた？
Shannon had refuted Jessica's words uncharacteristically forcefully, so Jessica caught on immediately.
Yeah, そういうことはないかと。
そういや、ジョージ兄さんってあまり浮いた話を聞いたことないし。あれ？確か家庭的な子がタイプだとか前に聞いたかな。そりゃいいぜ、シャノンぴったりじゃん。
あ、私がですか？そんな、私にはその、そんな資格ありませんし。
資格はあるぜ。何年も昔から顔を合わせてて、半ば幼馴染状態。互いに男女であることを意識しないナチュラルな関係ってのは、一度意識し始めるとトントン拍子らしいぜ。うんうん。
Jessica loved teen magazines with these kind of stories, and she was always on the phone talking excitedly with her friends about that kind of thing.So she had a keen intuition for this kind of romantic topic. So this wasn't the first time a topic like this had been brought to Shannon. But it was certainly the first time she had noticed George as a member of the opposite sex. She was furniture, and George was an honored guest connected to the Ushiro Miya family. She had thought it impermissible to even imagine any deeper relationship. So she hadn't thought about it.Jessica was taking immense pleasure in poking fun at all this, since it didn't affect her. Shannon was doing her best to make sure that her blushing cheeks weren't discovered. So, if George showed up at a time like this, there would be no way that she would be able to keep her cool. They saw George come out from the entrance hall of the mansion. It looked like he had seen them as well. He headed over, waving his hand.Shannon had to frantically try to regain her ordinary composure before George reached them.
おじい様がやっと降りてきたよ。
お？ That's a surprise.
あとは大人たちの話になるからって追い出されてね。
そりゃ抜け出して正解だよ。じい様の顔を拝むくらいなら疫病神にキスした方がマシだぜ。
そんな言い方は悪いよ。ただ、おじい様は僕らのことを疫病神だと思っているかもしれないね。何しろ、事業用にお金を借りたいという話でやってきたんだから。
That's right. This wasn't some customary annual October family conference. Eva's family had visited to apply for a business loan from the main family. Kinzo had vast resources, and he lent those out to his children.Of course, this was not money to lend because they had gotten themselves into financial trouble. How would they expand their business using the vast amount of money that they borrowed? How much interest would be attached and how soon could it be repaid? This wasn't a loan for the have-nots. It was a loan for those who were on the offense. Kinzo judged strictly whether it was worth lending out his fortune and afterwards he strictly oversaw its use.So there was occasionally this spectacle where relatives visited Rokkenjima and explained their business to Kinzo. To the parents, it may well have been a meeting concerning the movement of large sums of money, forcing immense stress upon them. But to Jessica, who lived on this isolated island called Rokkenjima, it was a precious opportunity to meet up with her cousins. So even her bad mood from getting into that fight with her mother,was immediately cured by this chat with the infrequent visitor, George.
うちも全くケチくせえぜ。金なんて余ってるんだろうから気前よく貸してやりゃいいのによ。うちの親父もじい様もどうせねちっこくもったいぶってんだろうぜ。
お金を貸すとき慎重になるのは当然のことだよ。もちろんうちの父さんも借り入れた分で事業を拡大ししっかり返却できるプランを持って訪れてる。あとはプレゼンテーション次第ってところだろうね。
So this is what they mean by the rich get richer.
本当は脇で見させてもらって勉強したいんだけど、母さんに追い出されちゃったんだよ。ちょっと残念かな。
親方様はクラウス様やエヴァ様のことを今でも子供の頃と全く変わらないように叱られるようです。そんな姿を息子のジョージ様にきっと見せたくないのでしょう。
As Shannon hung her head, she thought back on those scenes she had grown used to seeing while working in the mansion. Even Kraus, who acted haughtily towards his siblings, was still treated like a child by Kinzo. Shannon herself had often seen Kinzo slapping Kraus or making him sit in Seiza style.It was probably deeply humiliating to have that forced upon him at his age. In the Ushiromiya family, taking care not to be present when this happened was one of the great tasks of the servants. Of course, that did mean that Shannon had been making mistakes by being witness to it.
そうだろうね。それを察して姿を消すのも子供の務めかな。それにしても今年もこの庭園の花は本当に素敵だね。
George stretched as he said it. And truly effortlessly, he changed the subject away from something that had been a little gloomy. This time, Shannon noticed it too. This person, George, was highly sensitive to the mood of a group and was always caring enough to change the subject to something harmonious. It had been so smooth that Shannon hadn't noticed it until today.Today, Shannon had to really admire that behavior of George. Almost all of the boys Shannon knew of her own age were her classmates during her education. But they were all immature, and none of them had the composure that George did, even though he had just been another guest until moments ago. Now, she couldn't describe him with just that. But that was idle thinking, irrelevant to her work as a servant.Shannon tried to chase it away with a small shake of her head.
ん?どうしたんだよ?
あ、いえ、なんでもありません。あの、お茶のご用意をしましょうか?その、先ほどのアールグレイを改めてご用意します。
紅茶の名前、覚えてくれたんだね。嬉しいよ。
その、その、さっきはお気遣いをありがとうございました。
Shannon was finally able to put her thanks into words. If you wrote them out on paper, they wouldn't seem like much. But Shannon had needed just a little courage to say them out loud. But George played dumb.
何のことだい?お礼を言われるような覚えはないけど。
It seemed he was being a gentleman in his own way, saying that he hadn't helped her because he wanted to be thanked. It seemed that George's response had been more or less predictable to Jessica. She burst out laughing uncontrollably.
なあ?こういうところ気ざったらしいだろ?
いえ、そんなことは…
Jessica made fun of Shannon as she remained silent, red-faced. George didn't know the details, but he naturally joined in, laughing the same way. The three of them lazily walked around the garden, talking about what was new. George, as the oldest cousin, talked about his life experiences. Jessica talked about recent life on Rokkenjima, and Shannon talked about her recent work.These silly little topics went round and round in circles. Even when the other stories had been fascinating, Shannon had never felt particularly connected to their contents. She was nothing more than a servant, and she had no intention of delving into her master's lives. She simply wanted them to enjoy their time speaking with her, and was only pretending to listen intently and nodding at the right moments. But for some reason, she found talking with George deeply interesting today. Even for things that she would normally ignore, she felt like she could feel a kindness hidden beneath the words. For some reason, she wanted to know more things about George, no matter how trivial. So she stared fixedly at him. She thought that as far as looks went, this person, Ushidomiya George, was probably about average, and he didn't really stick out. But he was diligent, serious, and deeply thoughtful in a way that allowed him to understand people's hearts and care for them. But she had never been aware of these things until now. She might not have met him many times, but she had known his face for many years. Even so, she had not noticed once until now. So Shannon felt ashamed of this, and her cheeks went red. Maybe George thought that Shannon was appreciating him talking about himself because he continued to relate his personal stories. But Jessica didn't miss that slight change in Shannon. So she turned the discussion around to the topic Shannon wanted to hear about the most.
そういやさ、 ジョージ兄さん、 いい加減に彼女とかはできたわけ?
なんだい、やぶから棒に。
Normally, George's reaction would have been answer enough. But for some reason, as she was now, Shannon found herself unable to understand it unless he said it clearly.
その、ジョージ様はお優しいですから、さぞや、その、表になるだろうと。いや、その…
よせよ、シャノン。そういう追い詰め方はかえって意地悪だぜ。私は別に意地悪のつもりは。嬉しい勘違いをありがとう。残念だけど、特定の一人の女性とは見ての通り、容姿も並以下だからね。女の子を楽しくさせてあげられるような気の利いた話術もないし。
I can't believe George doesn't know how much of a catch he is right now.
そんなことないと思います。それに男性の魅力は容姿では測れないところで決まるんじゃないかと思います。だからそのジョージ様はとても魅力的な男性じゃないかとその思います。
Shannon was uncharacteristically verbose. Compared to her normal self, she was being very wordy indeed. George looked fairly pleased about hearing his own charm described, but he was just a little surprised at this high praise. Jessica, sure now that her own imagination was right on, acted as though she could barely hold back her laughter.
ありがとう、僕に魅力を感じてくれるような。
寛大な女性に早く巡り会いたいね。きっと巡り会えると思います。ジョージ様の本当の魅力に気づいている女性はきっと大勢いらっしゃると思いますよ。She
probably wanted to say that there's a girl not very far away. She avoided saying that much, drawing a final line as a servant.
そうかな。さすがに照れるね。Maybe
he had never been praised this much by a girl. George's face turned just as red as Shannon's. As she watched the two of them, Jessica giggled sadistically.
ジョージ兄さんもやがては素敵なパートナーと出会うだろうけどさ、今のままじゃきっとジョーズにパートナーをエスコートできないと思うぜ。
金面でいらっしゃるようだけど、そっちのお勉強はからっきしみたいですよ。わ、悪かったね。その勉強は これから少しずつしていくよ。
相手もいないのにどうやって？恋愛映画でも見る？それとも秀吉おじさんに習う？
ちぇ、まるで鬼の首でも取ったみたいだな。こういう話では男は女の子にかなわないね。
Normally, when George and Jessica got together, their parents would say, George is diligent and admirable, and Jessica is lazy and rude. So it was probably irresistible fun for Jessica when their roles were finally reversed. George also realized that, so this time he was content with being the one who was teased.
George 兄さんさえいいならさ、シャノンでちょっと練習してみたら？シャノンを一日退屈させずにデートに連れてくんだよ。どうよ？
そんな。お嬢様。
When she heard Jessica's audacious plan, Shannon's face turned bright red and a donut of smoke rose from it with a poof.
それはとても魅力的な提案だけど、シャノンちゃんに悪いよ。彼女の貴重な休日を奪うだけじゃない。彼女が本当に思いを寄せる人と二人きりで過ごす聖域に僕が割り込んでしまうことになる。そんな無粋なことはできないね。
私も、その、思い人とかそういう人はいませんので、その、そういうお気遣いは、はい、無用なのです。
Shannon's blood had all rushed to her head, and it looked like even she didn't know what she was blabbling about. Jessica, who knew how Shannon normally was, seemed to find that really comical. She couldn't hide her cackling laugh anymore.
そうなのかい? Shannon-chan みたいな可愛い子が独り身なんて信じられないね。
I mean, if her only place is the island, then it's kind of believable.
私、使用人ですから、その、男の方との縁なんてありませんし、その。
ってことは、シャノンも将来素敵な男性を射止めるために、交際の練習が必要だってことじゃないのかよ。つまり、二人とも互いの思惑は一致するわけだ。なるほど、こりゃいいぜ。
Jessica irresponsibly cheered the two of them on.Now, George was also hanging his head, red-faced.
George? さっきから呼んでるわよ。聞こえないの?
Since Eva appeared in what was already an embarrassing situation, both of them became even more flustered. Jessica was in stitches.
あ、母さん! ごめんよ、話が込み入っちゃっててね。気づかなかった。
これはエヴァ様。大変失礼しました。
若い子たち同士で大層盛り上がってたみたいね。あなたたちもみんなお年頃だもの。そういう話題が尽きないのもよくわかるわ。
嫌ですね。エヴァおばさんだってまだまだお若いじゃないですか。秀吉おじさんとの馴れ初めを聞かせてくださいよ。
あらあら、そんなの言えるわけないわよ。本当にみんな若いんだから。
それで何、母さん。用があって声をかけたんじゃないの？
お父さんたちの話が終わったわ。おじい様にあなたの話をするからいらっしゃい。
僕の話？何の話かな？
今みんなでしてたのと同じ話よ。ほら、例の話。
あの話かい。
Like an arranged marriage?
別に、おじい様に話すようなことじゃないんじゃないかな。
何の話だよ。まさか、長寿兄さん、誰かと結婚するの？
それはおめでとうございます。
違うよ。特定の女性はいないってさっき言ったじゃないか。
威張ることじゃないでしょ？まったく。
Eva smiled bitterly, looking a little exasperated.
わかった。
ジョージ兄さん、あれでしょ、お見合いだ。
お見合いですか。
まあね。
As a man, George undoubtedly wanted to find a partner by himself and carry her off himself. So it seemed that he found the idea of meeting his partner for the first time in a marriage meeting arranged by his parents to be a little pathetic.
お見合いというのは、もっと年齢が成熟してからするものじゃないのかな。僕はまだ一人前になったって自覚すらないというのに。
もちろん、即結納即結婚なんて焦る気は全然ないのよ。親睦を深めて年齢的にもう少し落ち着いてから籍を入れる形でも問題ないの。
From the forceful impression Eva was giving and George's evasiveness, it seemed that you could catch a glimpse of how this marriage meeting linked into everything. Who this other person was remained unclear, but it was surely someone profitable to Eva's family in a business sense.It felt almost like a political strategy. They wanted to create a connection between two families, if not by changing registers, then at least by having them get engaged.
結婚はね、好きになってからするものじゃないの。してからなれることよ。
Oh, I don't like this mindset.
感情だけで結婚すると必ず後悔する。身元のしっかりした人を生涯の伴侶に選んで、それから愛情を築いていくのも決して間違ったことではないの。
エヴァおばさん、それじゃ秀吉おじさんに悪いですよ。
私はあの人のこと大好きよ。いつまでも一緒にいて人生を共にしていきたい。
エヴァ様、素晴らしいです。本当にご立派です。
ありがとう。でもその気持ちは二人で夫婦をしていくうちに育んだものよ。そして今の私たちより未来の私たちの方がもっともっと仲良しだと信じてる。私は夫婦はそういうものがいいと思ってるの。
だからって好きでもない相手と結婚してもいいって論法にはならないと思うけどな。
だからって、好きな相手なら誰と結婚してもいいという論法にはならないわ。結婚は一瞬。でも、その後の夫婦生活はずっとずっと長いの。だから、一時の感情に任せず、慎重に相手を探すべきなの。そしてそれは、人生経験の未熟なあなたより、お母さんたちの方がうまくやれるとは思わない？
それはそうかもしれないけど。
あなたは私の自慢の一人息子よ。どこへ出しても恥ずかしくないくらい立派に成長してくれたわ。バトラ君は席を抜け、あなたが今やお父様の血を引く唯一の男孫。
Wait, so this is like, a few years ago? I guess? Was it six years ago? I guess it's 6 years ago when Butler left?
あなたにふさわしい相手は慎重に選ばなくてはならない。
As everyone related to the Ushinomiya family knew, Eva adored George so much that he was the apple of her eye. But that didn't mean she had pampered him. She had raised him strictly, and he had grown into a charming man who wouldn't betray her expectations. That's how he was the apple of her eye.
あなたの相手は決して母さんたちの損得で決めてなんかいないわ。あなたにふさわしい、本当に素晴らしい女性に母さんが合わせてあげる。
I mean, this definitely explains why she was so unhappy with, George proposing to Shannon.
今はあなたの中にある青臭い若さがそれを疎むかもしれない。でも、これだけは母さんの言うことを聞きなさい。私があなたのためを思わなかったことが一度でもある？
それはないけど。
今はそれで結構よ。さあ行きましょう。お父様を待たせてるわよ。急いで屋敷に行きなさい。
じゃあごめんね、二人とも。また後で。
George bowed to the two of them, and after bowing once more to Shannon, he dashed off to the mansion.
じゃあおばさんも行くわね。楽しい話を打ち切っちゃってごめんね、ジェシカちゃん、シャノンちゃん。
いえいえ、気にしないでください。じゃあシャノン、私たちは行こうぜ。
はい。
大丈夫よ、ジェシカちゃんだってきっとそのうち素敵な出会いがあるわよ。ジェシカちゃんにふさわしい素敵な方がね。
私と同程度ってことは成績の悪い男かな。なんだかうぜえぜ
もちろんシャノンちゃんにもね、あなたにふさわしい素敵な男性がきっと現れるわよ。
はい、ありがとうございます。
As Eva giggled and smiled, she approached Shannon's ear with a hand over her mouth, as though she was trying to tell her a secret. Oh no, I don't like this. She's gonna tell her to stay away.
使用人不在のあなたにぴったりの相手がきっと見つかるわよ。
Wow, I hate this.
義務教育に行かせてもらった恩も忘れて、身の程を知りなさい。
そんなつもりは。私、
ジョージはお父様の血を引く孫の中では嫡男に当たるのよ。ひょっとしたら未来の後ろ宮家を背負うことになるかもしれない人。その期待に応えるためにたくさんの勉強を重ねて素晴らしい大学に入り、素晴らしい成績を残しているわ。そんなジョージと無能無資格無教養な使用人風情が釣り合うと本気で思い？
I hate this so much. I really hate Eva right now. Oh goodness.Those malicious words all poured into Shannon's ear without spilling a drop. To Shannon, it was like cold water was being poured in there.
私は…そんなつもりは…
This was all whispered in secret, and with the same smile as before. Jessica, who could only see Eva's expression, didn't think it was anything other than Eva telling Shannon some kind of embarrassing story about love. When their secret conversation ended, Eva patted Shannon's shoulders as though to underscore her message.
大丈夫よ。あなたにぴったりのお相手がきっと見つかるから。ね。じゃあね、ジェシカちゃん。また後でね。
はい、また後で。秀吉おじさんとの話、その時聞かせてくださいね。
いやーよ
Eva laughed dryly and headed back to the entrance hall. Behind Jessica, who was cheerfully waving her hand,Shannon reflected very, very deeply on those words of Eva's about knowing her place. I felt deep remorse for my brief moment of conceit. I had forgotten. I am furniture. Furniture isn't human. So I am a being who must feel gratitude for even being treated like a human.And I am not permitted to wish for anything more. Even if people developed affection for furniture that they're using, that is an emotion on the human side, and the furniture has no right to hope for that. They should just serve with simple honesty every day. But that feeling I felt when talking with George Sama and Jessica Sama is a forbidden drug for me. In other words, it may have been an emotion I must not know.
シャノン、先ほどからぼんやりが過ぎます。体調でも悪いのですか？
いえ、失礼いたしました。
Natsuhi's words, too distracted, were right on the mark. Even Shannon couldn't believe that she hadn't noticed Natsuhi until she had been called. This was supposed to be the time when she had to concentrate on the cleaning. But she had just kept sighing and hadn't accomplished anything.
たとえお客様がおられなくても、 常に気を張っていなくてはなりません。そんな様では後宮家に仕える使用人として情けありませんよ。
はい、以後注意します。
もうじき当主様と主人がお帰りになられます。書斎の清掃は済んでいますか？階段の清掃は済んでいますか？
申し訳ございません。まだです。
ええ、知っています。ですからルノンにやらせておきました。あなたがもたもたと廊下を清掃している時間で、彼女は書斎と階段の清掃を済ませてしまいましたよ。
それはその丁寧にお掃除をしていたから時間がかかってしまって。
Shannon was simple and honest, so she would carry out her tasks seriously and properly without any omissions. So she was always slow with her work. In contrast, Lunan skillfully cut corners wherever they should be cut, so she could complete her jobs with a result that looked similar to an outsider, but in a much shorter time. In other words, she was shrewd. Compared to her, we should say that Shannon, who had just talked back to Natsuhi when she was already in a bad mood, was not shrewd in the slightest. Right, that was a really bad move on Shannon's part. Of course, there was nothing that Natsuhi couldn't stand more than the servants talking back. Her forehead creased and she spoke sternly. And yet, her speech was slow and admonishing, which was terrifying beyond measure, and finally made Shannon realize she had said the wrong thing.
ならば、存分に丁寧な清掃を心がけなさい。シャノン、あなたにこのまま大広間の清掃も命じます。当主様の大切な絵画が多数飾られ、後宮家への賓客をお招きすることもある。誇り一つ残さないよう、あなたが納得するまで丁寧に清掃なさい。もちろん今日中にです。それを終えて私に報告するまで食事も休憩も許しません。
Oh no.
わかりましたね。
はい。
結構。使用人はその言葉だけを口にするように。次の口答えにはより厳しい罰を与えますから、そのつもりで。
Ah, I was starting to like Natsuhi, and then I remembered why I didn't like her in the first place.
よく胸に刻んでおきなさい。
はい、ご指導をありがとうございます。
どういたしまして。
Natsuhi headed off down the corridor, making a gesture as if her headache was troubling her. Once Shannon couldn't see her anymore, she hung her head and sighed. This happened because I let my thoughts take me. I might be bad at everything I do, but I should at least be able to carry out the cleaning as well as an average person can, right? I can't even do that properly. It's so pathetic, it makes me cry.And then there's something even more pathetic. Not only was I unable to perform a single bit of cleaning well, but just now when Natsuhi was scolding me, I was envisioning him appearing and rescuing me. If only George-sama had been there, perhaps he would have casually stepped in and saved me.I'm sure he would show up cheerfully, intentionally acting like he doesn't know what's going on, nimbly change the subject, and make me forget I was ever reprimanded by Natsuhi. I kept envisioning him, suddenly appearing from the other side of the door, the other end of the hallway. I envisioned the kind of person that would be an appropriate partner for him in the marriage meeting.And I envisioned how unfitting I am for him. Eva had told me that clearly. It had repeated endlessly through my dreams.
姉さんは相変わらず不器用だね。奥様は今朝から虫の居所が悪い。黙ってうなずいていればいいものを、余計なことを言うから。
カノン君。
Canon was suddenly there. His footsteps were always quieter than a cat's, and he left no trace of his presence. She probably wouldn't have noticed him, no matter how long he stood there. The expression on Cannon's face was hatred. That expression he was making, he surely made for Shannon, who didn't know how to do so herself.
奥様も、 そしてルノンも地獄へ落ちろ。
あいつは奥様がどこをチェックするか知ってて、そこしか掃除しない。さっきの掃除もそうだった。見ていたから知ってる。本当の意味での掃除なんかしてないんだよ。丁寧に掃除する姉さんに寄生してるだけの最低なやつだ。そんな汚い言葉を使ってはダメよ。汚い言葉はカノン君の綺麗な魂まで怪我してしまう。だからせめて
私の前ではそんな言葉遣いをしないで。And faced away, acting sulky. It was a dishonest reaction, very like Kenan-kun. But I was a little happy. He got angry in my place.
大広間の掃除は大変だよ。僕も手伝う。ありがとう。でも、奥様に命じられたのは私だから大丈夫。
カノン君にも自分のお仕事があるんでしょ。汚らわしい仕事だよ。僕の魂なんてとっくに汚れてる。Oh
my goodness, what's this about? Cannon then hung his head and bit his lower lip.
手伝ってくれるという言葉だけで私は十分。カノン君も自分の仕事に戻らないとあなたまで罰を受けることになっちゃう。
Shannon knew Cannon's character well. Sometimes he didn't reflect on himself. If I don't refuse forcefully, he will help me, even if it means neglecting his own job. Cannon was a little sad that his favor had been rejected. But he realized that in the end, going too far would also cause her pain, and he gave a single small sigh. Are we not gonna expand on Cannon's filthy job? That's what's making me curious right now.
わかったよ。姉さんも頑張って。うん。それに、私にも責任はあるから。姉さんには責任なんて何もないよ。うん。あるの。だから。
Kenan-kun's face showed that he still hadn't completely accepted it, but he stopped being persistent and disappeared. Even though Kenan-kun had given me words of comfort when I was down, even so, I was still dejected because it hadn't been him. That was simply a sin. Far beyond any dream the likes of me could be permitted to see, know your place. Shannon, who had neglected breakfast, was already starting to feel her thoughts attenuate. But if she didn't finish cleaning the reception hall, she couldn't receive Natsuhi's permission to eat. That cruel Natsuhi had surely told the kitchen of that. I have to respectfully receive Madam's punishment. That's right. My position in this world is furniture, and I had been intoxicated by a dream that is beyond me. I finished cleaning the hallway and went to the reception hall. Maybe hunger made a nose more sensitive. The kitchen was far away, but somehow I could smell the delicious aroma wafting from there, stimulating my empty stomach all the more. Until I finished up here, I could not get any soup. I just had to prepare myself. Several portraits were hung in the reception hall. One of those portraits was thought amongst the servants to hold a special meaning. It was the portrait of the witch. That wasn't its true name, but everyone in the mansion called it that. The name of the woman with elegant blonde hair, drawn as the subject of that portrait, was Beatrice. It was whispered that she might be the former mistress of the family head, Kinzo. And also that she was the great witch who had given Kinzo his legendary gold. The witch, Beatrice, master of the night on Okenjima. She was gracious to those who respected her, but she would always curse those who made light of her. It was in Shannon's character not to neglect rules and beliefs such as those. So she thought of the portrait of her other master as that person herself and always treated it carefully, treasuring it. And it had become part of her daily routine to talk inside her own head to the witch who only existed inside the portrait. She was furniture. Furniture doesn't complain. Cannot complain. She had no right to speak her mind about her difficult days. No right to open her mouth and say those words. So, she at least spoke her mind inside her heart. Those words she couldn't say aloud, she spoke inside her heart and protested to the formless witch. Of course, the witch didn't answer. She never consoled and she never laughed it off. Shannon could only interpret that silence as she liked, as though the witch was at least listening attentively.
Beatrice-sama, misborashii watashi no hanashi o kiite kudasai.
As Shannon wiped the dust from the witch's portrait, she spoke inside her heart.
Watashi wa tashikani, Eva-sama no yuu toori, 無能で無教養な家具です。人じゃない。だから恋をする資格などないかもしれません。でもだったらどうして恋をすることのできる心などお与えになったのでしょうか?
Shannon paused there and held back her tears for a time. The sound of the rain which had started falling, along with the chill air in the reception hall, made her feel as though her shabbiness had increased another level.
本当の家具なら心なんかない。だから人を愛したりしなくて済むじゃないですか。だから苦しまない。私も同じ家具なのに。 どうして心なんかあるんですか? こんな苦しくて辛い思いをするなら こんな心なんて与えないでほしかった!
Oh my goodness.
なるほど。 家具に心を与えたか。 あれも時には愉快なことをする。
The witch who never answered or laughed, answered and laughed. My imagination? Hearing things? No. After all, the next words became a voice, and I could hear them, not with my heart, but with my ears.
人間は 世界を構成する元素について紀元前の昔から探求を続けてきた古代ギリシャ人たちは風、火、水、土の4つで世界の説明を試みたというその後も数千年かけて人間たちはその4つに様々な元素を加え5代、6代、7代 8代、12代と様々な解釈で世界を説明しようとしたが唯一の真実である一なる元素を説明することはできなかった。しかし星の導きによって現れた一人の男がついにこの世界を構成する一なる元素を説明した。 何かわかるか?
え、あ、だ、だ、だ
Shannon fearfully turned around. Oh my goodness. She really is there. Right there, she existed. Not as an illusion, in reality. The contrast made by the lightning made it clear that this was not just a daydream.
それは愛よ。
The witch of the portrait elegantly held a golden pipe to her mouth, and she giggled. She laughed at the ignorance which caused mankind's thoughts to stray far from the most simple answer.
その男は世界のすべてを愛で説明した。それこそが一なる元素。男は最小の数で世界の構成を説明しきったのだ。なんとも単純明快にして、豪快爽快愉快痛快。やがてその男の生まれた年は西暦紀元と呼ばれるようになったがな。
Shannon lost any words to speak. She thought that when first meeting an unknown guest, her first words should ask that person's name. But without saying anything, Shannon knew this person's name, so she refrained. No. Surely, as a person of this island, asking this person for her name would be the greatest disrespect. Because she was the other master of this island, in addition to Kinzo.
Beatrice-sama!
いかにも、わらわがベアトリーチェである。千年を経ても、人がわらわを見て最初に浮かべる表情は変わらんな。
The witch giggled at how Shannon's reaction didn't betray her expectations. Shannon realized that she had met with a being that mustn't be met with, and she took a step backwards. That's where the wall and the portrait were, so even as she gazed at the witch, she supported the witch's portrait on her back.
お前の悩みは愛ゆえよ。それはすなわち世界の一なる元素。つまりこの世のすべてだ。それが満たされぬということは世界が満たされぬに同じこと。それは穴の開いた水筒に水を汲み続けるのに似ている。汲めども汲めども満たされぬ永遠の心の砂漠。人間の基礎にしてすべてにして現在。わかるか。知識の実を口にしたアダムとイブが知ったのは愛だったのだ。それを知ったがゆえに人は楽園を追われ人足りえたのだ。
That's what Shannon was saying in the beginning, right? That she was already chased out of paradise. Because she fell in love?
すなわちそれは愛を知り苦しむからこそ人であること。心優しき娘よ。そなたは誇っていい。それを知った今、そなたはもはや家具にあらず。そなたは今こそ人間なのだ。我が名にかけてそれを認めようぞ。凡庸の身には理解もつらき話か。まあよいわ。許すがいい。久しぶりに人間と話すのでな。饒舌が過ぎたことを謝ろう。
Without expecting a reply from Shannon, Beatrice laughed pleasantly for a while.
わびと言ってはなんだが、わらわの力で。そなたのその願望を叶えてやってもよいぞ。
The meaning of those words surprised Shannon even more than a witch's sudden appearance.
そなたを思い人と添い遂げさせてやってもよいと言っている。本来ならばそれに見合うだけの対価を要求するところだが。
わらわは機嫌がよい。それにそなたはわらわへの礼を欠かさず今日までよく尽くした。それへの褒美としてやってもよい。
本当ですか?
Normally, Shannon would have been shocked by this guest who lacked realism and wouldn't have been able to speak. However, as though she had already been caught in a witch's trap, Shannon responded to the witch.
わらわの魔法にかかれば、思い人と結ばれるように取り計らうなど造作もない。
You do mean it, don't you?Those words almost escaped Shannon's lips, but she held herself back with final reserves for reason, off reason. A witch is a witch, a sinister being. The witch Beatrice is clearly trying to slip in through the cracks in my heart and take me prisoner. That sort of temptation, which so many fairy tale picture books had warned me about when I was young, was right in front of me now.
If もまた。敬いの一つよ。心地よくはあるが、これでは埒が明かぬな。わらわは確かに、そなたらが忌み嫌う魔女像から離れはせぬ。だが、わらわは敬う者には好意を返す。それは人間も同じであろう。そのように身構えられて好意を返せる人間も、またおらぬと思うがな。
失礼しました。そんなつもりは。
Shannon finally realized that her hostility was rude to the guest. And she finally digested the words that had been spoken to her a short while ago. You are no longer furniture. Now, you are human. The more she reflected upon those words, the more Shannon felt as though Beatrice could understand all of her suffering.
さっきの、その、褒美の話って、何ですか?
お前が、その心を虜にする男と結ばれるように、取り計らってもいいと言っている。わらわの肖像画を、日々丹念に磨いてくれたことへの礼とでも思うがよい。安心せよ。対価は求めぬ。わらわは気前がよい。だがな、対価は求めぬが、頼みがある。
Look, here it comes. The other Shannon inside her heart sent her a warning. This is what she had been so often warned of in all those scary picture books she had read when she was little.
この島のすぐ近くの海に、岩が覗き、そこに小さな鳥居と祠が設けてあるのを知っているか?
I'm assuming this is the same shrine and 鳥居 that was missing in the beginning of episode 1. Shannon immediately remembered it. When you reached Rokenjima by boat, there was a 鳥居 and a shrineOn a reef which was too small to be even called an islet. She had the feeling that Kumasawa had told her its history, but she couldn't remember that very well. A traveling mountaineering ascetic or something had, or someone had built it, or prayed at it, or something.
知っていますが、それが何か?
魔に通じぬ者に一から説明はせぬ。早い話がだな。あれには参っておるのだ。実はな、あの祠の中に、ある鏡が収められている。それをそなたに割ってほしいというのだ。
That was a very suspicious request.Shannon didn't know its history, but anything that might be stored inside a shrine would have to be something sacred. And she wants me to break it? Why would someone as powerful as a witch be unable to do that herself and be asking a human for help? There was no need for Shannon to speak her thoughts aloud. Beatrice started talking about this reasonable question before Shannon could give her answer.
あの鏡の魔力は、わらわの魔力と相対する。人の言葉でうまく説明できぬな。例えれば、食器の違いとでも言おうか。あの鏡はフォークで、わらわの力はスープなのだ。フォークでスープは飲めまい？あの鏡の押し付けさえなければ、わらわはスープを飲むのにぴったりのスプーンが用意できるというわけだ。それさえあれば、スープも飲めるし、岩楼だって掘り抜けるぞ。目玉だってえぐり貫ける。だったか？
何の話かわかりません。私の無教養のせいだとしたら謝ります。
こういうことだ。あの忌々しい鏡をわらわのために割る手間をかけてくれたなら、その褒美として、そなたの願いを叶えてやるということだ。今日のわらわは本当に機嫌がいい。そなたが望むなら、願い事を変えて、金蔵に授けた黄金を丸ごとくれてやることにしてもよいぞ。
お断りします。
なんと。
When she heard Shannon's words, Beatrice realized for the first time that her expectations had been betrayed.
理由があれば聞かせよ。誤解があるなら解こうぞ。
理由なんて、よくわかりません。でも、今日までこの島は平和で、何も起こりませんでした。なら、鏡を割らなくても、今日までと同じ平和が、これからも続いていくはずです。
うん。なるほど、なるほど。それはもっともだな。そなたの言う通りだ。あれを割らぬなら、割れぬ今日までと同じ日々が、わらわが絶対の保証をしようではないか。ベアトリーチェの名にかけて言う。割れぬ今日までと同じ日々が、明日も明後日も続こうぞ。
But that's not what happens, right?
それは永久に。永遠に。
It's ominous, because she is the witch of endlessness, huh? Shannon was seized by an eerie illusion. The mirror was most likely something to restrain the witch.So breaking the mirror should have been something done for the witch's sake. And yet, it felt as though Shannon had to do it for her own sake. It felt like some premise had been switched.
わらわはあくまでも、褒美としてそなたに思いを成就する機会を与えたに過ぎぬ。割ろうが割るまいが、そなたの自由だ。割れば、わらわはそなたの願いを叶える。割らねば、今日までの明日が永遠に続く。そなたの願いは永遠に叶うことはない。わかるか？何を言っているか。
The witch was telling her.She was pressing her, saying to break the mirror if she wanted to be joined with George. And she was declaring that if she didn't break it, then her feelings would definitely never be fulfilled.
やめてください。そうなの、聞きたくない。
そなたを苦しめたかったわけではないのだがな。まあいい。愛に苦しさを感じるも、人間の醍醐味よ。その感情を存分に楽しむがよい。だが、我が力を借りたいと願ったなら、いつでもあの鏡を割るがよい。そして、我が名を叫び、呼び覚ますがよい。わらわは必ず約束を守るだろう。
So that's what she was doing in the beginning.
これならば文句はあるまい?そなたに今すぐの決断を迫るわけではない。気楽であろう?
Was this deal ultimately something she could feel at ease with? Definitely not. To Shannon, who was burning with love, tormented by passion, being tempted forever by a way of escape was far too cruel a trial.
この約束に期限は設けぬが、願いを叶える魔法には期限がある。その期限は、わらわが決めるのではない。そなたの思い人が自ら決める。意味がわかるか?
わかりません。
I also don't really understand.
そなたの思い人が、愛のちぎりを結ぶべき相手を決めた時が、その期限となる。
Oh, I see.
わらわは魔女だが、鬼ではない。互いを愛し合う二人を引き裂く魔法は、持ち合わせていないのでな。
It's such a ominous line, harkening back to the epitaph about tearing apart the two who are close.
そなたの思い人は近いうちに見合いに臨むそうだな。そなたは世界で一番その男のことを思っているかもしれん。だが、世界で一番ふさわしいとは限らんぞ。わらわは見合いの相手を知っている。その娘は世界で一番後ろ宮ジョージにふさわしい。良い学校を出て、良い成績を残し、落ち着きがあって思慮深い。お前より美しく、お前より聡明で、お前よりふさわしい。
Even her way of speaking is so similar to Eva, and she's 100% taunting Shannon into making her decision.
お前のような無知無能無教養の娘がどうしてふさわしかろうか。お前が一番知っている。お前が一番ふさわしくない。お前と後ろ宮ジョージが結ばれるなど想像するだけでも罪深い愚かしいことよ。愚かしい愚かしい身の程知れい。
義務教育に行かせてもらった恩も忘れて身の程を知りなさい。ジョージはお父様の血を引く孫の中では着ないに当たるのよ。ひょっとしたら未来の後ろ宮家を背負うことになるかもしれない人。その期待に応えるためにたくさんの勉強を重ねて素晴らしい大学に入り素晴らしい成績を残しているわ。そんなジョージと無能無資格無教養な使用人風情が釣り合うと本気で思い?
Oh my goodness.
やめろ! シャノンをいじめるな! 貴様は誰だ!
At that time, as Shannon held her head, trying to protect her heart from the blade of Beatrice's word, Cannon ran in front of her.Kenan didn't care who this woman was. As long as he knew she was an enemy tormenting Shannon, who he loved and respected as a sister, nothing else mattered.
Kanon-kun, 下がって! この方は…
It seemed that Kenan also realized that the being standing before him was the one and only witch of the portrait. And also that she was a terrifying being.
シャノンに褒美を取らせたかっただけだが、わらわの言葉が過ぎ、いじめてしまったようだな。それは謝ろう。だが、先ほどの約束は、そなたへの褒美として残してゆく。 わらわの力が必要ならばいつでも呼び出すといい。その方法はすでに教えた。ではこれにて今宵は退散しよう。敵意の眼差しは心地よくあるが、美容にはちと悪いのでな。
消えろ。お前が何者か知らないが、お前はシャノンを脅かしている。二度と現れるな。
It seemed that Cannon's words made the witch horribly displeased.
言葉を選ばぬか下賤め。わらわは敬う者に寛大だが、敬わぬ者には残酷であるぞ。
While she still smiled, the witch's expression began to warp.An oppressive feeling that couldn't be described with any other five senses gradually filled the room. Even though they couldn't comprehend what it was, they immediately realized it to be something terrifying. If you were swimming in the ocean and something large went by in the water beneath you, you would want to escape to the land even before you learned what it was. This was the same as that.
Oyamekudasai, Beatrice-sama!カノン君はまだ子供なんです。言葉遣いについては謝ります。
Cannon blocked the way to Shannon at the risk of his life. There was tense sweat on his forehead. In that moment, the witch certainly had Cannon's fate in her clutches. She didn't even need to move a finger. She had Cannon's fate so readily in her grasp that she could crush itcompletely with a single twist of her own smile. Cannon also understood that, which is why he was sweating, and his knees felt weak. However, Beatrice abruptly released the feeling of tension and laughed.
よかろう。そなたが求めるなら、特別に許そう。カノンとやら、彼女に免じて、今宵は許して使わす。感謝するがよいぞ。さて、今宵はこれで退散する。別れの挨拶に一つ土産を残そう。二人とも左手の手のひらをこちらへかざせ。
Beatrice grinned broadly and snapped her fingers, whereupon their left hands stretched out in front of them and their palms opened against their will.It was a strange sensation, as though only their left hands had become someone else's. It felt like their left hands alone had become puppets, pulled by strings hanging down from the ceiling.
これは何の真似だ！
Cannon resisted, but he couldn't take back the freedom of his left hand.
騒ぐな。すぐに済む。
Beatrice held her pipe aloft, and from inside the smoke, gold-colored sparkling dust hovered in the air. Oh? That glitter eventually became several gold butterflies. The beautiful butterflies danced freely throughout the reception hall, creating a fantastical and beautiful world. And two of those butterflies alighted on the palms of Shannon's and Cannon's hands.There was a sharp pain, as though they had been burned. When the two of them tried to examine their palms, there was no trace left of that inability to move their bodies, which had been there until a second ago.
Also, これは?
On the palm of her hand, a small burn mark had been made, the size of a pea. Furthermore, it was shaped like a butterfly.
これは何の真似だ?
Apparently, Shannon had the same bruise on his hand. He stared at the witch hatefully.
単なる挨拶よ。大はない。ただのあざに過ぎぬから、ほんの数日で言えよう。手当ても必要ない。それは、わらわが確かに今日ここにあり、そなたと約束を交わしたことを、明日に忘れさせぬための印だ。
Then why burn Cannon too? If the promise was made between just Shannon and Beatrice,
わらわとの出会いは刺激が強い。翌朝にわらわとの出会いを夢か幻と思い込み忘れようとする人間も時にはいるのでな。
Maybe this is why。
ゆっくり考えるがいいぞ、シャノ。そしてゆっくりと休み、明日の朝日に我が印を見て改めて考えてみるがいいだろう。わらわは何も強要せぬ。そなたが自らの意志で自由に未来を決めるがいい。もっとも欲する者の対価がその程度で済むとはな。悲恋をテーマに戯曲を書き上げた偉人たちが悔しがるぞ。それでは縁があったらまた会おう。久しぶりの会話は実に楽しかったぞ。さらばだ、カグども。
Beatrice's body crumbled like smoke and blew away. It was golden smoke, no, a flight of golden butterflies. They scattered in all directions inside the reception hall, leaving a golden mist behind as she disappeared into thin air. After that, only the silence was left. The extreme silence was enough to make both of them think they might have been daydreaming until just a moment ago, which is why the witch had left it.She left a mark to make it impossible for them to think that this was a daydream. As Shannon and Kenan thought back on the butterfly bruises on their hands and the pain they had felt when those had been left, they stood there for some time, stunned and motionless. And from that day on, Shannon was tormented by days of suffering and conflict.Wonderful Utopia.Well, guys, this was a very long one. I'm glad we gained some insight into what happened leading up to the events of that fateful day documented in Maria's notebook. And it seems like Shannon has played a part in leading up to that incident with her destroying the mirror in that shrine.Although still right now, I don't really understand what the mirror is about. Just that, from what I know, mirrors are like a portal to another world or another dimension. But maybe that mirror has a different kind of significance. Anyway, I don't think this prologue is over yet, right? And I'm still curious to see how this is gonna lead up to what happened in episode one. Because right now,I believe this is what happened before episode 1. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. Let me know your thoughts in the comments down below. I'll see you next time and bye! Hello everybody. So, I found an interesting thing when I was editing the video, which was that the key that is in the riddle, it might be the same key that Shannon was talking about when she was throwing the mirror into the sea. And that key, from what I understand, could either be the mirror that Beatrice told her to break, since it restrains Beatrice's like power, or it could be the feeling of courage, which Shannon mentioned. She said that those cowards who never risk loss,will never be given a key. And at the time when I was reading it, I didn't really consciously process it, I think, because everything was happening so fast. But upon editing the video, I found it really interesting that she mentioned the word key. I don't know if this is something that you would typically say in that situation, but the word key definitely stood out. Maybe because I keep thinking of the epitaph. But yes,So, I think it's possible that Shannon was actually the one who basically kickstarted the whole string of murders, according to the epitaph. So she was the one who was given a key. Although I can't explain what the part about the shore was about, but well, it was the shrine was at the reef or the cliff near the sea, close enough. But well, it was Beatrice and not two people who told her about that location. So there might be more, but I think Shannon might be the one who possessed the key. The other thing was that Beatrice kept mentioning that the single element that makes the world is love. And well, I think right now it's hard to say what I can do with that information, but I thought it was interesting. And the last thing was, well, hear me out. It might sound ridiculous. It's probably ridiculous because it's really just speculation. But basically, what I wanted to say was, what if the reason why all the seagulls are gone when Battler came, like, in episode 1, what if the reason why they are all gone is because none of the sweet fish is left in that river? Maybe. And maybe the beloved home of old is not referring to Kinzo's ancestral home, but to Beatrice's own home. She is, after all, the master of the island, but I don't know if she lived there before meeting Kinzo, whether that really is her actual home of old. So I thought those were some interesting points that I found when I was editing the video. Yeah. That's it for me. So if you like this video, give this video a like. If you like Battler, like I do, give this video a like. If you feel sorry for Shannon, give this video a like. Or don't. It's completely up to you, honestly. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time. Bye!